Okay. Hello everyone. So as per the last previous session, you saw about the RTOS and IDE for the embedded system. So more in previous lectures, we observed that more concentration on RTOS or basic concepts of operating system. There are some specific concepts like task, process, thread with the help of example, multi-processing, multitasking. Then how they'll these tasks can communicate each other, and how the synchronization can be takes place. Now, in today's session, we're going to discuss about the integration and testing of embedded hardware and firmware. Okay, here we're going to discuss about the block diagram, how the hardware and firmware can be communicate, or how it can be loaded into the target board. Then disassembly and decoding also discuss it. Then also discuss about simulator, target hardware, and last part is the boundary scanning. Okay, so first start with the embedded system development in environment. Then move on to next slide. Now we'll discuss about the integration and testing of embedded hardware and firmware. Okay. Now, here today we'll discuss about the testing of embedded hardware. In that, we'll discuss about the integration of hardware, firmware. What technique is followed? That is out of circuit programming, then in system programming, then in system programming with the SPI protocol, then application programming, then use of factory program chip, then the last part is the firmware loading with the operating system, and last part board bring up. Okay, now these are the ways how we can, after writing your assembly program or any high level C program or C++ program, we need to program and load it into that program. Usually call it as a firmware. That firmware have to copy into the target device. Okay, so we can copy. These are the ways are there. Okay, nothing but whether that embedded device is with operating system or without operating system. Okay, first start with out of circuit programming. These are the topics I'm going to cover up it in this. Okay. Here main target is that how we can load the firmware into the hardware. These are different techniques are there with ISP, IAS, with the help of some operating system, with the help of some simulation, or with the help of emulator also. Okay. First we'll start with the first technique. Now, usually first start with any embedded system designing, first we'll concentrate on hardware part. Okay, how much the ROM, which processor is used, or which ARM model is used, how many IO devices are there, how many ports are with them, hardware completely designed in. Okay, these are hardwares are connected to the target processor. That processor can be ARM 7, 8, 9 or any other processor or controller also. Now we need to run this hardware with the help of one software program. We call it as a firmware. Okay, that firmware we can simulate it first. Okay, simulate environment nothing but that simulator acts like a target controller or processor, whether we can able to implement on that target processor or not. Okay, this we can done with by selecting the proper controller. Okay, then you can go for it. For example, in the Kyle compiler that we can do it. Okay. Now here, now this firmware usually acts like a controller which provide to it's provide the access for register or any other status. Now nothing but the statement we can, I'll read that one. What happened inside processor or controller and what are the states of various peripherals. That is everything shown by this simulator. Okay, simulator example is here. IDE we call Integrated Development Environment. Example is here, Kyle. It's not only Kyle. There are many simulators are there. Different manufacturers having different. That they have their own form. The IDE they have developed it. Okay. The Kyle is more popularly used because it supports more number of controllers. Okay. Now. Integration of this hardware and firmware, nothing but that firmware come load into the that complete target hardware. Okay, nothing but embedding the intelligence, nothing but embedding that software into that hardware. Okay, so nothing but before you embedding, you must know the on which target board or processor or controller working on it. You should know about it. Now nothing but how much in the RAM size, ROM size, that everyone should know that. After generating your firmware, the size of the firmware must fit into the ROM of that target controller or processor. Okay. Now in case of non-OS based embedded system, firmware is the only stored on the chip. Firmware nothing but only program is stored. There is no nothing operating system or any GUI kind of thing or any graphical interface. Nothing is there. Only the complete firmware is included. That is non-operating system based. Operating system based having usually they having a GUI interface and some like colors or graphical interfaces are there, or any additional application also are there. Now come to the next topic, that is part is the out of circuit programming. So this is out of circuit programming, nothing but we perform this outside the target board. Okay, nothing but we are not directly working on any target controller or processor or any kit also. Sometimes called target board, also called kit. Okay, so we'll first only load the required firmware into the flash ROM of the controller or processor with the help of these kind of out of circuit programming. Here one example is given, that intelligence universal programming. It is designed by lab tool. Okay, so this is the IC. You have to place the IC. This is IC socket where you have to place the that controller or processor into this, and whatever generated your firmware software, dump into that or load into this or flash into the that target controller or processor. Okay, this is about out of circuit programming. Nothing but we are not working on direct board, only working they will take out that complete processor or controller and keep into this device. Okay, to only to program it. Okay, or to store the load the programming. Usually we call it as a flashing, reflashing. Most of them heard about mobile reflashing. This is the way we can do it. Okay, only we can connect to the mobile internal ROM that it can reflash it. This is out of circuit programming. Now how this can be achieved? This is one simple layout way, typical layout followed for any embedded system. It's not that only to the ARM based, any embedded system. This is your target PC where you are wrote your firmware with the help of any IDE, example Kyle, and that is connected to the device programmer through some COM port, serial port or any US port. Nowadays type C ports also are used to program it. With the help of RS-232, if it is serial, if you are using or serial port or COM communication port you are using it. USB cable, most of more popular nowadays if you are using working with the USB port. Okay, so this is the way, this is typical one arrangement where you have to load the program from your target host computer to the target device, which is placed inside this IC socket. Okay, this can be your ARM7 or any other processor like controller of like a bike controller, example bike, microwave oven, washing machine. That is, that controller is placed in that. Controller processor is placed into that. Now, how this we can do it? Usually, first we connect it, the host machine. The host machine connect to the device program with the help of cable. Then with the help of IDE is present in the computer or host machine with the help of, and select the target device, for example ARM or 8051 or any other microcontroller, there are number of microcontrollers, choose it. Then get that IC from the board and place into this IC socket. For example, I am working on ARM7, I will take out the ARM7 from the target board and keep it into this device programmer IC socket. Then after that, I'll connect with the help of communication, with the help of USB port, and convert my firmware or software which is present in the IDE, that it I'll convert into the hex file. Usually hex file is nothing but binary file only. That binary file only we can load it into the hardware, because your hardware can understand, or that chip of processor control zeros and ones, that is loaded with the help of any flashing interface software or flashing software server. Okay. The typical steps are followed to load the firmware program into the controller. Okay. There are many drawbacks also are there. Main drawback is that it need more development time. Then frequency of insertion and removal of IC, possibility of damage it, possibility of breaking of pins also. Then when it deployed into the market, nothing but after launching into the market, we can't do anything in that. It's very difficult to do any upgradation in that. It's not possible. That's the reason it is more or application point of use only in low end embedded devices, like it does not run with the help of operating system, like handheld games or any video games, where you can't do anything in that. Okay. Like microwave oven, washing machine. So in that mode, popularly used these things. Okay. Now ISP. ISP is also similar to the out of circuit programming only. Here the difference is that instead of taking out the IC from the target board and keep it into the device programmer in the IC socket. Now instead of this is time consuming, take out the IC and keep it into the socket of the device program. Instead of that, if you program directly on the target board, okay. Target board we can program with the help of, again same technique will follow it, will connect through some serial or parallel port or USB port. Okay, more popularly ISPs are used JTAG. JTAG means joint test action group, or some serial peripheral interfaces are used. Okay, so here nothing but, I'll go back to the previous slide. Now here in this ISP, absence of this device programmer, directly you can use your target board also. Okay, target board. So nothing but directly I'll copy that whatever firmware from the target board itself. So no need of additional device to any program, no need of it. Okay. That is the main advantage of ISP there. That is small difference between the out of circuit programming and ISP. That this we can achieve with the help of two serial protocols are followed, that is JTAG and SPI. So here advantage is that if you are working with target board, you can do n number of times reprogramming, you can do it, you can analyze it, what exactly going on in the hardware, how many memory is utilized, how many number of RAM is utilized, all the location we can study it, nothing but runtime we can analyze. That is the main advantage of ISP. Okay, ISP, in that it usually follows some, as I said, that SPI protocol. Okay, The SPI protocol nothing but one kind of communication between master and slave. Master is usually host machine and slave is your target board. Okay. So target board include EEPROM chip. That chip can be inside the controller or off the chip also, or outside the or externally connected to the processor or controller. There are various IO lines are used, like a master out, slave in. Master out nothing but the host will send the firmware from the host machine to the target device is here slave. Exactly opposite, master in, slave out, from slave to target board to the host machine communication, the system clock, then reset the target device or ground the target device. Okay. So these are basically used to reset nothing but start working from the beginning. Ground of the target device nothing but completely erase it or make it dead, does not do anything, or make it erase all the content of it. So these are various control lines are used in that. Then clock is, as you know, that basically used for data transfer or synchronize the operation between the various control lines like MOSI, MISO, so that everyone should not generate its control signal at the same time. That we need to sync with the clock. Now, in more popularly, SPI protocol boot ROMs are used. Boot ROM. Okay, this is factory program boot ROM. Nothing but before it can be programmed or it can be changed during manufacture only we can program it. If it is possible, if your firmware or boot ROM program is in the size, memory size is very small, like in few kilobytes, the better preferably use the SPI protocols. If it is beyond like megabytes or in GB also, we can't use this kind of programming. Okay. Now come to the in application programming, IAP. We saw that previous two, out of circuit programming, then in system programming, and now come to that is ISP, then now come to IAP, in application programming. Okay. Now here, the in application programming is not used to store the complete firmware or complete any software into the target device. Here, with the help of application, some additional application which is loaded into host machine, with the help of will modify the small changes in the firmware. If anything wrong or something small changes we have to do it or upgrade the firmware, that for purpose you can use the in application program. It is not used to store complete from the like boot ROM programs we can't do in the IAP. Only we can do the modification, the small changes in the complete program. The use of factory programming chip, it is possible to embed nothing but during manufacturing the process, factory only will completely store the program into the chip and it will come out, so that it never can be modified or nothing can be changed it. But it is mass production, we can do it, no need to flash it every time, massly we can program all the ICs, but it need more expensive ICs required. That is the major only problem. Rest all easiest method. Okay. Now come to the loading firmware with the help of for operating system based. Exactly same what technique you followed out of circuit programming or in system programming or in application. Same technique is followed it, but more widely used ISP, in system programming technique is used. Instead of loading your firmware, will load the complete operating system into the RAM or ROM of the target controller or processor. Most of the time in the ROM it is, or flash memory it is loaded. That usually complete operating system we call it as OS image. Image is nothing but a complete operating system software loaded into the target board. Okay. Come to this board power up. Now what happened during this programming, the possibility of regressive reflashing, regressive burning the firmware into the IC, or number of times changing or upgrading the firmware. So the because of successive reading and writing, the IC get heated because it startly using it more power from the power source, the heavy current start flowing inside the IC, so chances of some explosion. Okay, so that's why we need to carefully need to handle it. You should know that before reading and writing, how many number of times you can read, write, how much the power supply we need to provide it. There is should not be cross connection between plus and minus of the power supply. Should be properly connected. Or in sometimes what happened during manufacturing itself, some components are connected reverse order or wrongly placed, that also create the problem. So before programming into your target board must be tested, or it can be tested or approved by some authority, then only you can go for the program. Okay, now in the next session we'll discuss about the embedded system development environment. Thank you.